पिण्याचं पाणी याची फार मोठी गरज आहे आणि ती गरज भागवण्यासाठी या जलसंधारणाच्या कामातून निश्चितच सरकारला फायदा होईल. फिनोलेक्स इंडस्ट्रीज लिमिटेड आणि त्यांचे CSR पार्टनर मुकुंद माधव फाउंडेशन यांच्या वतीनं हा जो कार्यक्रम इकडंच या माळशिरस तालुक्यात घेण्यात येतो आहे तो अतिशय उत्कृष्ट कार्यक्रम आहे आणि त्याबद्दल सर्व याचे जे काही भागीदार आहेत त्या सगळ्यांचं मनापासून अभिनंदन करतो.
A very good and refreshing Friday evening to all of you from Indian Plumbing Association. We'll be starting the webinar shortly. A very warm welcome to all IPA, NEB, NEC members and members from supporting organizations, our industry partners for today in today's webinar on a very emergent topic that is rainwater harvesting, an age-old technique that has been used, that was being used in ancient India and is now being revived again to cater to our water wars. So to start the event formally, we would like to play the national anthem first. So I'd like to request everyone to rise on their seats for the national anthem.
Sushant, an issue?
Jana Gana Mana Adhinayaka Jaya Hai Bharat Bhagya Vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkala Vanga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga Uchchala Jaladhi Taranga तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
थैंक्स अ लॉट ऑल ऑफ यू सो अ वेरी एज आई सेड अ वेरी गुड इवनिंग एंड वॉर्म वेलकम टू ऑल ऑफ यू एंड आई रिक्वेस्ट ऑल ऑफ यू टू स्टे ग्लूड टू योर सीट्स एज वी बिगिन दिस energizing and exciting knowledge ride on rainwater harvesting. So to give an introductory address about the webinar today, I would like to I would like to invite Mr. Minesh Shah, Chapter Chairman, IPA Ahmedabad Chapter. So you are mute. You have to unmute yourself.
Okay. Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Okay. Good evening and namaste to everyone. Today we have almost 490 participants as of now, and they are still increasing. Once upon a time, there was a small village. In that village, everyone was happy because the people had enough food to eat, as they had enough water to grow their crops, and the children had enough clean water to drink and bath. And the cows that gave them milk had enough water to drink. The potter made his pots using water. The weaver colored its cloths using water, and they all used water which drew up from the pumps. And the water in the pumps came from many hundreds of feet below the ground. This water which lies below the ground is called groundwater. The villagers kept drawing this water up until one day it was all over. And can you guess what happened then? The people of the village was very sad now, and so they went looking for the ways to bring back the water. Can you guess what they did to bring back the water? The villagers were told by some wise men that they had to harvest or collect the rainwater. This is rainwater harvesting in a very simplest meaning. And how to do rainwater harvesting and what methods can be adopted shall all be covered in next hour or so. With this small introduction of today's topic, I am very happy and obliged to welcome our expert speaker, Mr. S. Viswanath, IPA President Gurmit Singh, NEB, all my NEC colleagues, all panelists, entire HQ team, all ladies and gentlemen for today's technical webinar on rainwater harvesting. I would also like to welcome the entire team of today's partner, event partner Phenolex Pipes, along with Mr. Pradeep Verula, who is President Sales and Marketing, to this beautiful evening. In principle, rainwater harvesting consists of intercepting rainfall where it occurs, saving the water in various storage structures, which can be natural or man-made, percolating it in ground to raise groundwater, prevention of losses through evaporation and beneficial used stored water locally. In the universe, life is known to exist nowhere except the earth. Modern science unequivocally believes that life cannot exist without water. Life has sustained on our earth for 3.5 billion years because of some extraordinary attributes of the earth.
Sir, sorry to interrupt you. One of the person in the attendees has said that, can you be a little louder?
Okay. One such attribute is the hydrological cycle, by which a small fraction of all fresh water in the earth is circulated over and over again. One part of rain falling on land flows in rivers and streams towards the ocean, and one part of it goes back to atmosphere as evaporation and as transpiration by the plants. The remaining part circulates underground as subsoil water and groundwater. It is within this simple and yet profound framework that rainwater harvest needs to be understood. Rainwater harvesting is the need of time today for the reasons like growing population, modernization, industrialization, ill effects associated with them, global warming, abnormal changes in the hydrological cycle, growing difference between availability and requirement of water globally, acute shortage of fresh water, or I would say potable water. The lack of awareness of rainwater harvesting has resulted into overexploitation of surface sources like wells for drinking and industrial use, resulting into dropping of water levels and drying up of bore wells. So now let us all catch the rain where it falls, when it falls, with our expert speaker of the day, Mr. S. Viswanath, from whom we all will gain knowledge on rainwater harvesting from his vast experience and some good works he has done in this field. Before moving on, I would like to inform you all that IPA have planned a series of technical webinars, with today being the first one. We have planned total 7 webinars in 2021. Now onwards, from next month, every Friday, fourth of the Friday, we will have one such session on various technical topics being taken by a professional expert. Next month's webinar will be on 23rd of July, Friday, same time from 5 to 6:30 p.m. So I request everyone to please block your time slot and day to listen to other technical experts. In the end, I'll once again like to thank you all for a wonderful support, motivating and encouraging us so that we keep on doing good for the industry. A special thanks to the entire IPA webinar committee for coming up with such a program for creating awareness on various technical topics. I would like to mention the support from Mr. Chirag Pagadar and Mr. Dignesh Trivedi, you who bring in support from today's event partner, Finolex Pipes. Without them, we need a sponsor for every event, and today our event support has been from Finolex Pipes. Thanks, and over to you, Nivedita, for the further actions.
Yeah, thank you, sir. So for an interesting introduction about today's session, I hope all of you have got an idea about how we have structured the session today. So now I call upon our national president, Mr. Gurmeet Singh Arora, to give us his presidential address on the looming water crisis. Over to you, Gurmeet, sir.
You are on mute.
I'm sorry. Can you hear me now?
Yes, please.
Yes, sir.
With the permission of the dignitaries, I will try and speak in Hindi now. If I make any mistakes, I apologize in advance. Mera naam Jal hai. Mujhe log pyar se alag alag भाषाओं में पानी देशों एक्वा बोडा वैंड चाइनीज में सीयू टू बी जर्मनी में वासेर आयर और महा माँ भी पुकारते हैं एम ए ए माँ. हर प्रकार अलग अलग स्थानों पे मैं पाया जाता हूँ. भारत में आप मुझे थानेर वेलम नीरू नीरा और जलम से पुकारते, जल पानी. हिमालय की चोटी देख लो, समुन्द्र सागर का किनारा देख लो, कोई नदी देख लो, बीना लेक महाबलेश्वर में भोपाल की पांच लेक, बर्फ जो आप अपनी कोल्ड ड्रिंक में डालते हैं, आइसक्रीम हर जगह में पाया जाता. आपके अंदर भी 70% मैं हूं. मेरा इस्तेमाल अलग अलग चीजों में किया जाता है. मैं जल वायु अग्नि धरती आकाश का एक बहुत महत्वपूर्ण इम्पोर्टेंट हिस्सा हूं, क्योंकि जल के बिना कुछ नहीं बन सकता. ये सेल फोन में 3000 लीटर पानी लगता है, 3000 लीटर पानी लगता है ये सेल फोन बनाने में. ये टी शर्ट बनाने में 2500 लीटर पानी लगता है. एक कप कॉफी में 140 लीटर पानी लगता है. एक केजी चावल में 3000 लीटर पानी जाता है. एक केजी वीट गेहूं में 1350 लीटर पानी जाता है. गब्बर सिंह कहता था, 50-50 मील दूर माँ कहती है बच्चे को, दूध पी लो नहीं तो गब्बर सिंह आ जाएगा. एक गिलास दूध में 1000 लीटर पानी जाता है. 1000 लीटर पानी 250 ml दूध में. मैं हर जगह हूं. लोग इंग्लिश में कहते हैं वह एनर्जी फ्लोज फोकस ग्रोज. मैं कहता हूं वेर वॉटर फ्लोज फोकस ग्रोज, क्योंकि आपके लिए कल के लिए पानी नहीं है. अगर आप सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल्स देखें जो 17 है, उसमें 6 प्रकार के सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल्स में मेरा हिस्सा है. गुड हेल्थ एंड वेलबींग, जो मैं आपको आगे समझाऊंगा, क्लीन वाटर एंड सैनिटेशन, सस्टेनेबल सिटीज एंड कम्युनिटीज नहीं हो सकती मेरे बिना. आपका कोई भी खाना नहीं पक सकता मेरे बिना. क्लाइमेट एक्शन, लाइफ बिलो वाटर, लाइफ ऑन लैंड, ये 6 सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल है जिससे मैं किधर ना किधर मेरी अटैचमेंट है उनके साथ. 70% संक्रमण रोग जो होते हैं, कम्युनिकेबल डिजीज, वो गंदे पानी से संचारित ट्रांसमिट होते हैं. कॉलरा, टाइफॉइड, डायरिया, बहुत सी ऐसी डिजीजेस हैं जो गंदे पानी से ट्रांसमिट होते हैं। डायरिया से रोज 3,000 बच्चे मरते हैं। ये कोविड 19 से भी खराब है। आप कोविड 19 से डर रहे हैं, डायरिया रोज 3,000 बच्चे लेती है, रोज 3,000 बच्चे मरते हैं, और आप क्या कर रहे हैं? आपको कहते हैं पब्लिक हेल्थ इंजीनियर। आप किस किस्म के पब्लिक हेल्थ इंजीनियर हैं? अब आप 3,000 बच्चों की मौत से नहीं बचा सकते उन्हें। वो आपका पहले फर्ज है कि हम कैसे साफ पानी दें लोगों को, बिना कोई डिजीज के, बिना कोई रोग का पानी दें लोगों को। ये हमारा फर्ज है। आपकी इंडियन प्लम्बिंग एसोसिएशन, भारतीय प्लम्बिंग एसोसिएशन का फर्ज है कि आप कैसे पानी बचाएं और पानी को गंदा करने से रोकें। मगर आप क्या करते हैं मेरा? आपके देश में, मैं एक बहुत स्ट्रॉन्ग वर्ड यूज कर रहा हूं, मैं माफी चाहता हूं, आपके देश में केस हो जाते हैं, लड़की को ऐसे टच करते हो, बोलती है बलात्कार हो गया। आप क्या कर रहे हो? आप मेरा बलात्कार कर रहे हो, आप पानी का बलात्कार कर रहे हो। आपने मेरे समुन्दर में, सागर में इतने माइक्रो प्लास्टिक डाल दिए हैं कि जो भी वहां के जीव जंतु, मछली जो भी खाता है, उसको कैंसर होने वाला है। आपकी कैपिटल दिल्ली से 54% पानी अनट्रीटेड सुएज के साथ आप यमुना में, मेरे यमुना में डाल देते हो, और फिर कहते हैं इंडिया की सब नदियां खराब है। खराब करने वाले कौन हो आप? यू, आपको साइक्लोन, टोर्नाडो, सुनामी, ये सब का इफेक्ट हो रहा है, क्योंकि मैं आपको छोड़ूंगा नहीं, मैं आपको छोड़ने वाला नहीं। जितना आप मेरे को खराब करोगे, उतना मेरी फ्यूरी वापस आपके ऊपर आएगी, मेरा गुस्सा उतना आपके ऊपर आएगा, मेरा आक्रमण उतना आएगा आपके ऊपर। कभी ओडिशा में, कभी वेस्ट बंगाल में, कभी गुजरात में, मैं कभी सुनामी भेजता हूँ तो कभी साइक्लोन भेजता हूँ। जल और आयु मिल के आपको सिखाते हैं कि आप क्या कर रहे हो, आप नेचर का डिस्ट्रक्शन कर रहे हो। एक एसोसिएशन है, भारतीय प्लम्बिंग एसोसिएशन, आपको पता है उन्होंने 133 करोड़ लीटर पानी 2019 में बचाया है, सिर्फ लो फ्लो फिक्स्चर्स के साथ। उनका 2020 में टारगेट था 500 लीटर पानी, ये अंदर की बात मैं आपको बता रहा हूँ, किसी को बताना मत, 500 लीटर पानी बचाने का उनका, उनके तौर तरीके, उनके, उनका एक प्लान था। लेकिन कोविड 19 के कारण आपको पानी भी ज्यादा चाहिए, हाथ धोने के लिए, डिसइंफेक्शन के लिए, आपके डिसइंफेक्टेंट्स में भी पानी लगता है। क्या आप पानी के बिना जी सकते हैं? आप मुझे बताइए। अगर आप रूम छोड़ते हो तो आप पहले स्विच बंद करते हो, एसी बंद करते हो, पानी का नल क्यों नहीं बंद करते? आपको किसने बोला कि आप मोहम्मद रफी या लता मंगेशकर हो कि आप शावर के नीचे गा सकते हो? बाहर जाइए, बिस्तर पे चढ़िए और गाइए, जितना गाना है गाइए, 2 घंटा 4 घंटा। आपको किसने बोला आपका जो फ्लश है, पॉटी है, डब्ल्यूसी है, उसमें आप सिगरेट डाल के फ्लश कर सकते हो, अपने बाल डाल के फ्लश कर सकते हो? मैं जल हूं, मैं कल भी था, कल भी रहूंगा। आप रहो नहीं, ना रहो, मैं आपके बिना जी सकता हूं, आप मेरे बिना जी नहीं सकते। याद रहे, ये याद रहे, आप मेरे बिना जी नहीं सकते, क्योंकि आपकी हर चीज, विचित्र चीज, अच्छी चीज, बुरी चीज, हर चीज में आपको पानी चाहिए, और हाइजीन और डिसइंफेक्शन के लिए तो पानी चाहिए चाहिए आपको। आपके देश में 17% दुनिया की आबादी है, लेकिन सिर्फ 4% फ्रेश वाटर है। क्या करोगे आप? आपका मिनिस्टर बोलता है नल से जल से स्कीम, 30 लीटर पानी हम हर गांव में पहुंचाएंगे, हर गांव वालों को, गांव वाले को कहां से आएगा पानी? जब तक आप, आपकी एक वो कैपिटल है कर्नाटका की, बेंगलुरु, केप टाउन के बाद वहां पानी खत्म हो रहा है, क्योंकि आपने फॉसिल वाटर को भी निचोड़ लिया है। जमीन के अंदर कब तक जाओगे? भारत माँ की कोख तक पहुंच गए हो आप, 800 मीटर जा रहे हो 2400-2500 फुट पानी के लिए, आप कर क्या रहे हो? और वो भी पानी आपका हार्ड पानी, हार्ड वाटर आता है, उसके साथ और भी चीजें आती है, रोग आते हैं। अगर आपको पानी माँ की कोख से निकालना है तो पहले उसे वापस डालिए एक्वाफर में, उसको रीइंफोर्स कीजिए, अब आप वापिस खींच सकते हो उसको। आप टैंक भरोगे नहीं और टैंक से पानी निकालना चालू कर दोगे तो कब तक निकलेगा, एक दिन टैंक सूख जाएगा। तो मेरे आपसे दरख्वास्त है, मैं आज नहीं, जब से ये धरती माँ जन्म हुई है मैं यहाँ रह रहा हूँ, आपके बिना भी आपके पहले भी, इसीलिए मेरा, मैं आपसे हाथ जोड़ता हूँ, दरख्वास्त करता हूँ, मुझे सम्मान दो, मेरा अपमान मत करो, मैं जल हूं, मुझे सम्मान दो। मैं आपको कुछ चीजें बता रहा हूं जो आप पानी बचा सकते हैं, उसके बाद विश्वनाथ जी आपको बताएंगे, क्योंकि एक ही पानी का सोर्स है आसमान, बारिश का पानी जो साफ है उसको खराब मत कीजिए, उसको वापरिए, और एक एक्सपर्ट आपको यह सिखाने वाले हैं। ये भारतीय प्लम्बिंग एसोसिएशन में एक कोड है, वाटर एफिशिएंट प्रोडक्ट्स इंडिया गाइड, 2013 में इन्होंने बनाया था, 2017 में इन्होंने रिवाइज किया है, जिसमें आप टूटी नल शावर आप लगाएंगे, लो फ्लो फिक्स्चर, कम पानी वाला, कम पानी वापरने वाला, 30-35% पानी सेव करोगे। आप लो फ्लो सैनिटरी वेल लगाएंगे, आप 40-45% पानी सेव करेंगे। आप रेन वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग करिए, आप हर पानी को ट्रीट कीजिए, फ्लश का पानी सिंगापुर में कनाडा में ट्रीट करके बोतल में डाला जाता है, उसको काला पानी बोलते हैं, ब्लैक वाटर, ब्लैक और ग्रे पानी दोनों ट्रीट करके बोतल में बिकता है। हर कंट्री में ट्रीटमेंट है और ट्रीटमेंट हर जगह है, दिल्ली में 30% ट्रीटमेंट प्लांट ही नहीं चल रहे और बाकी जो चल रहे हैं अंडर कैपेसिटी चल रहे हैं, तो 50% से ज्यादा पानी बिना ट्रीटमेंट का आप डाल देते हो नदी में, आपको क्या फर्क पड़ता है? आपको नहीं फर्क पड़ता, आपके बच्चों और उनके बच्चों को फर्क पड़ेगा, क्योंकि आप सींचते जाओगे पानी जमीन से, एक दिन पानी नहीं बचेगा, और फिर आप पूरा बैलेंस चेंज कर दोगे, क्योंकि कितना पानी खींचोगे, कितना एक्सकेवेशन करोगे, उतनी जमीन भी नीचे जाएगी। एक हरित बिल्डिंग काउंसिल है, भारतीय हरित बिल्डिंग काउंसिल, उन्होंने अक्टूबर में, आपके वाइस प्रेसिडेंट ने लॉन्च किया है नेट जीरो वाटर, और उनका ये कहना है कि नेट जीरो एनर्जी, नेट जीरो वाटर, नेट जीरो वेस्ट और नेट जीरो कार्बन, 2030 उन्होंने कमिटमेंट किया है कि जितने इमारतें बिल्डिंगें इस धरती पे बने, इस भारत में बनेंगी, वो नेट जीरो बनेगी, और 2050 तक उन्होंने वर्ल्ड हरित काउंसिल को, दुनिया की हरित काउंसिल को कमिटमेंट दिया है कि जितनी बिल्डिंगें 2050 तक बनेंगी, वो जो पुरानी भी बिल्डिंग है उनको भी नेट जीरो कन्वर्ट कर देंगी। और बहुत से प्रोजेक्ट मैं भारत में देख रहा हूं जिनको पानी म्युनिसिपल कॉर्पोरेशन से नहीं चाहिए, जरूरत नहीं है, ना वेस्ट ना सैनिटेशन अपना डालते हैं पानी में, बाहर सुवेज में कुछ नहीं चाहिए, सुवेज लाइन में आप बिल्डिंग बना सकते हैं बिना ज्यादा खर्चा से, जहां आप अपना 100% पानी ट्रीट करके डिसइंफेक्ट करके यूज कर सकते हैं। मेरी आपसे एक ही रिक्वेस्ट है, एक ही दरख्वास्त है, मैं क्लोज करने पहले आपको एक और स्टोरी सुनाऊंगा छोटी सी, लेकिन कल बचाओ लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, सज्जनों कल बचाओ, जल है तो कल है, जल नहीं तो कल नहीं। अभी मैं आपको एक इंग्लिश में स्टोरी सुनाता हूं। द लाई सेट टू द ट्रूथ, लेट्स टेक अ बाथ टुगेदर, द वेल वाटर इज वेरी नाइस। So they got naked and bathed, but suddenly the lie leapt out of the water and fled wearing the clothes of the truth. The truth furious climbed out of the well to get her clothes back, but the world upon seeing the naked truth looked away. Poor truth returned to the well and disappeared forever, hiding her shame. Since then, the lie runs around the world dressed as the truth, and society is very happy. Because the world has no desire to know the naked truth. And I am telling you today the naked truth. We have no water for tomorrow. It is up to you, ladies and gentlemen. We have to work together as an Indian Plumbing Association, as builders, consultants, architects. We have to make so that we reuse every drop of water that we consume, and we stop abuse of water. Thank you very much. Thank you, Ivedisa. Thank you for having me.
Thanks a lot, Gurmeet sir, for that captivating address. And I hope he has shown all of us the mirror on how we are depleting our water resources and also toxicating them with a lot of waste and every filth that we have with us. So, and I hope that this has opened our eyes, and where we will now decide and act now, because it's now or never for all of us. So before we move further, let me inform you about Plumbex India Connecting Digitally. That is an IPA initiative that is to connect digitally with all our plumbing stakeholders. And that's an exclusive service for all our IPA members. So let's have the video to know more about Plumbex India. IPA members who have not registered to Plumbex India, do register, because this is your way of extending your branding and making your digital presence in this all the more digital world, wherein you can sell and promote your things only if you're digitally present. So to move on further, let's now invite our industry partner for today evening, Phenolic Spice. So I'd like to invite Mr. Pradeep Vedula, President, Sales and Marketing, Phenolic Spice, to address the audience with this presentation. So, sir, I'd like to inform you that the time allowed to you is 10 minutes. So I would request you to please stick to your time.
Thank you, Nivedita.
Thank you.
Good evening and a very warm welcome to all the panelists and other attendees of this webinar. I must really acknowledge Gurmeet Singh Ji for painting a very real crisis with all its intensity in a very vivid manner, which makes it real and an everyday issue for all of us. Thanks a lot, Gurmeet Singh Ji. And I hope that everybody who is on this webinar today and their families are safe and doing well in these unprecedentedly tough and uncertain times. Please do take care and I wish the very best of health for everyone. With that, I would move on to share a small introduction about Phenolics and the efforts that we have been making over the years in promoting water sustainability. I hope my screen is visible to everybody. Thumbs up, okay. Suffice. Great. Thank you so much. So just a quick introduction to Phenolics, though the name is in fact synonymous with PVC pipes and fittings in the country. So we are India's largest and the only fully backward integrated PVC pipes and manufacturer in the country. Our resin plant at Ratnagiri is one of the best in its class, and we have been market leaders in this segment for more than 4 decades now. That's longer than the lifespan of several companies in this industry and, you know, other similar industries. And the reason I say it's state of the art is because it has been built with technical collaboration with Uhde of Germany, who are one of the world's leading engineering construction companies who have designed more than 2,000 chemical refining and petrochemical plants across the world.
Sir, I would, sorry to interrupt you. Can you be a little louder? There's a request from the audience.
One second. Is this better, Nivedita?
Yes, that's perfectly better.
Thank you. Thank you. So just to quickly wrap up, you know, a brief introduction about Phenolics. Our pipe processing capacity is probably the largest in the country at 3.7 lakh tons. Our footprint spreads across the country, right from Jammu and Kashmir in the north to Kanyakumari in the south, from, you know, Maharashtra in the west to West Bengal in the northeast, the eastern part of the country. This is enabled through a very strong Phenolics parivar consisting of 900 plus dealers we engage directly with, and who further interact with 21,000 touch points, which comprises a very, very strong sub-dealer network in the country. As most of us would know, and which has been a fact for a fairly long period of time now, Phenolics is the leading player in the agricultural sector for PVC pipes and fittings, and is also one of the leading companies in the country today for the non-agri sector. We offer a full range of pipes across both the agriculture segment and the plumbing and sanitation segments. A lot of that has been made possible by our own internal R&D and technical teams. And with this brief introduction, I would just come quickly to what has helped Phenolics be such a strong brand in the country, and what role this focus around sustainability or water conservation has played in our journey. So there are three key pillars, I would say, of Phenolics' approach. The first and foremost, we have been known for our quality and reliability. Two, as I shared earlier as well, self-sufficiency has been a cornerstone of Phenolics' approach through all these 4 decades of our existence. And the third one, and probably the most important one, has been the focus upon sustainability as an organization. It defines who we are, it defines how we approach the market, and it defines how we define business for ourselves. It's not something dealing from sustainability, it is something that is driven by and which is sourced from our focus on sustainability. It is as important to us as, you know, hard-coded numbers of top lines and bottom lines and EBITDAs and stuff like that. It has been, and this approach, this focus has been recognized fairly widely through various honors and awards that have been conferred on us for our sustainability work and on our CSR work. We are probably the most awarded player and recognized player for our CSR and sustainability efforts in the country in our industry. A couple of highlights about what we have done around water conservation, both within the organization and in the communities that we operate in. Our mother plant, which is situated in Ratnagiri, we have built a dam on the river Thorli there. And this dam has made such a big impact to the water table there. It has helped us recover a significant amount of rainwater that would otherwise have run off into the nearby ocean. At our newest plant in Gujarat, in Masar, we have constructed 4 water harvesting wells. Each one of them is 250 meters across in diameter. That's about a quarter of a kilometer. All 4 of them put together is a kilometer in diameter and 60 meters deep. This helps us recharge the groundwater connected through stormwater drains. I'll show you this photograph that you see on the screen currently is of the dam that we built in Ratnagiri on the river Thorli. In the next slide, I'll show you a photograph of one of the surface water reservoirs that we built in the Ratnagiri plant. It has a massive, each tank has a massive capacity of 3 lakh cubic meters. Just to put that number into context, this is one of those reservoirs. It is measures such as these which have helped us live and work towards our stated goal or our principle of zero liquid effluent discharge. Today, I'm quite happy to share with all of you that in Ratnagiri, 50% of the effluent that we generate is recycled back into our manufacturing process. The other half is treated to exacting standards of the government and then is reused again within our own plant infrastructure for gardening and agricultural activities. At our Urse and Masar plants, we follow a similar approach. Not a single liter of water is left untreated or left unutilized. While we do all this within our own organization, there's plenty more that we do in terms of supporting communities or educating communities around rainwater harvesting and water conservation. Our CSR partner, Mukul Madhav Foundation, has been one of the leading organizations for driving societal and communal change in the country. Mukul Madhav Foundation works upon 9 of the 16 UN Sustainability Development Goals, which Gurbir ji had mentioned in his speech. In fact, one project that we did very recently in Solapur district, in the Katfal village, is directly connected to the UN SDG goal number 6. Of providing clean water and sanitation to communities across the globe. Our approach is not just centered around making a donation and letting grounds of the team run with it. It's a fairly structured 4-stage approach that has gotten recognized by and imitated by several other organizations in the country and abroad. We have a very thorough phase of project verification wherein we actually call in industry experts or topical experts. We collaborate with government organizations to provide the necessary authorizations for going ahead with each proposed project. We collaborate not just with government organizations, but with other like-minded people and entities and corporations to pool in the collective intelligence, to pool in the collective effort to really make a difference in each of the communities we operate in. When I mentioned communities, these are not initiatives that we do and hand over to the community. We believe very strongly that communities need to participate in and own the initiatives which are being driven in their areas. Towards that end, there's a very structured program, a very structured approach for calling in community participation and building our initiatives around it. And the last part, for us, a project that we have been a part of doesn't really end with the implementation of the project. It becomes a part of our life. It becomes a part of an ongoing monitoring mechanism where we consistently see whether the impact that was created has been sustained. Does it need a boost? Does it need some modification? Or does it need a course correction? And this approach spans for several years after the original initiative has been implemented. We have done a lot of work through these community and CSR initiatives in various districts in Maharashtra, in Gujarat, and across the country for encouraging and driving rainwater harvesting initiatives. we recently did a lot of work with schools in Gujarat, in the Masar area around our plant, for promoting and implementing rainwater harvesting initiatives, not just, you know, with grown-ups, but to create that sensitivity right at the school level. Because these children are the custodians of our future, and if they really buy into this, if they really get convinced about this, then we have done a little bit towards securing our future and theirs as well. That's the brief introduction and the efforts that we have put in and the journey that we have traveled as Phenolex in the sustainability initiative and the water conservation initiative that I wanted to share with you. Thank you so much, IPA, for this opportunity. And thank you so much, all the panelists and the attendees, for your patient listening. Thank you and stay safe.
Thank you, Mr. Vedula, for educating all of us on the work that Phenolex has done in rainwater harvesting. So now I'd like to invite B.O. Prasanna Kumar, sir, who is chapter chairman for IPA Bengaluru chapter, to acquaint us all with the expert speaker for the day, popularly known as Zen Rainman, Dr. Vishwanath Srikantaya, a popular water conservation expert. I'm very sure that all of us will love to hear from him and have a great time listening to this ardent speaker and environmentalist. So over to you, Mr. B.U. Prasanna Kumar.
Thank you, Nivedita. I'm audible, right? Yes. Very good evening, dear members IPA, members of supporting organization. Once again, welcome you to our first ever lecture of our webinar series, which is planned from this year. This is first of its kind in the our webinar series. So I have privilege to present today the eminent speaker. He does not require any introduction, at least for Bangaloreans. He is a water conservation expert who is renowned for his tireless and pioneering efforts to find the solutions to the country's freshwater crisis. He is a TEDx speaker. He talked on his talk on a city and its water in contest to livelihood perspective, viewed and appreciated by many. I'm talking about Mr. Vishwanath Srikantaya, a civil engineer from Mysore University. He did his master's in urban regional planning, Ahmedabad, postgraduate diploma in urban environment management, Rotterdam, the Netherlands. He is a trustee with Biome Environmental Trust. Mr. Vishwanath has 35 years of experience in his area of water, wastewater, and sanitation, helping in designing rainwater harvesting, aquifer recharge, wastewater recycling, and eco sand systems. He used to write a weekly column called WaterWise for at least 12 years for the Hindu, a national daily. And he has been part of expert committee for which he has helped to formulate the rainwater harvesting policy for Bangalore. It is really need of the hour. He worked on that tirelessly. And second, the water and wastewater policy for Karnataka. I have the honor in welcoming Mr. Vishwanath. Over to you, sir. We are eager to hear from you on rainwater harvesting, especially that is your today's topic. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. I hope the screen is visible.
Yes, sir, visible.
Right. So, and my voice is loud enough, Nivedita. Is that loud enough?
Yes, loud enough.
Right, thank you. Thanks to Mr. Pradeep Vedula. He made a very nice and very modest presentation for such a large company, which is doing so much, Phenolex, and also very heartening to see your involvement in CSR activities with government schools, especially. It was very heartening to see that. Thanks to Mr. Gurmeet Arora, who made such a passionate speech on water itself, Mr. Minesh Sharma, for having done the introduction. Thanks to the organizers, and especially to the participants who are here. I want to share some of my experience and some of my thoughts on rainwater harvesting. We cannot cover everything in the whole gamut of things, but a little bit, a little flavor of what India is going through and what India needs to do. That would be my endeavor. Like they say, Vanakkam, Namaskara, Namaste, and good evening to all of us. And in Telugu, they say, Endaro Mahanubhavulu, Andariki Vandanamulu. In the sense, Mr. Pradeep Vedula will understand that to those who have all gathered together, the wise people who have gathered, my namaskarams, right? So let me talk about traditional and modern methods of rainwater harvesting. Ours is a beautiful land of rivers. This photograph for me, which covers the major rivers and the river basins of India, is striking and it touches the heart. Sujalam, Sufalam, Malayaja, Sheetalam, when we talk about India, this is the imagination we have of the veins and arteries, the rivers, the rivulets, the streams, which nourish our land and which are a part of our heritage and a cultural heritage. It is unfortunate that right now the rivers are under stress for lack of water and that they are being polluted. It is my hope that as a society and as a community, when we work together, our ultimate goal is not just rainwater harvesting, but the revival of our rivers and the culture of fresh water in our rivers and the ecology and biology that goes with it. For us, the monsoon is everything. We are right now in the middle of the monsoon, 2021, June 1st to September 30th. These 4 months are critical. It gives us 70 to 80% of the total water endowment that India will have. 4,000 billion cubic meters is the average endowment that falls in a year. But it's in these 4 months that the bulk of it falls. And therefore, we have to treasure it, hold on to it in our soil, in our aquifers, in our rivers and streams, and make it last for the next 8 months. And it's been a cycle for thousands of years, if not millions of years. So the respect for the monsoon is there for us. We welcome it with great joy, even though it causes floods in some areas. But even in the flood-prone areas, the monsoon was welcomed because it brought silt and fertility to the land. The respect for the monsoon has to continue. But the question we ask ourselves, and Mr. Gurmeet Arora already made the point, is to ponder about why are our rivers dry and why is there a water scarcity? Of course, the one obvious question answer is that from 330 million in independence, we've gone to about 3,380 million people. But look at our food grain production. We're now a food self-sufficient country. From 50 million tons, we've crossed 300 million tons. Look at electricity generation. From 1,362 megawatts, we've gone to 374 gigawatts. And mind you, that all forms of energy, be it thermal, be it hydroelectric, be it nuclear, hydroelectric requires dams, thermal power plants require water for cooling, and nuclear power needs water. So energy and food generation has caused a great deal of pressure on our water sources. We have yet to become much more efficient at it, right? Look at the number of dams, 300 to 5,202. Dams are essential, but dams also prevent river flows, longitudinal flows of rivers, and cause ecological concerns, which now we are realizing, and we therefore are not in the era of large dams. We will have to manage with decentralized systems and structures most probably, and we'll have to do that with the rainwater harvesting. And I just give you one example of wheat alone. The high yielding variety of wheat, which came in the mid 60s, this needs more water than the traditional wheat variety. And just that expansion in wheat alone from 10 to 107 million tons means lots of water has been used for the production of wheat, and probably in areas where it was not necessary. For example, Punjab, we are now in the midst of a water crisis because of the wheat production. So this has been some of the causes why we are challenged with water. But if there's one point that I want to impress on the audience and in the participants, is what differentiates India from other nations is our dependence on groundwater. We are a groundwater civilization. 33 million wells and borewells. It will be more in number. 30 is what I put. 65% of our total water requirements, total meaning including agriculture, industrial, urban, and drinking water in rural areas. 85% of our drinking water needs. 250 cubic kilometers of groundwater being extracted annually, more than China and USA combined together. Those two extract 220 cubic kilometers. We alone extract 250 cubic kilometers. So our dependence on aquifers and groundwater is really, really big. And the only source of recharge for all of this aquifer water is rain. Therefore, the importance of rainwater harvesting, therefore the importance to value our aquifers, protect them, and therefore demand management to make sure that we don't overexploit, right? So what has this overexploitation of groundwater done? Not only has it depleted water in the red and pink areas, but it's also caused fluoride and arsenic to emerge, including nitrates and iron in many parts. So therefore, quality has been impaired and quantity has been impaired across vast tracts of India. It's not hardly any spot where it's not quality or quantity impaired. Therefore, we have to value the freshness of the water in the ground and make sure that we return back to the original quality that we used to get about 40, 50 years back. And that brings us to the question as to how much water does a person need, right? Just for livelihood. I'm not talking about just for life, not for livelihood or for economic goods. So the numbers are all up for discussion, 150, 135 liters per capita per day. Right now for our villages, we are designing systems for 55 liters per capita per day. But somewhere along the line in our cities, we'll have to figure out that 100 liters per capita per day is more than enough. And that should be the standard with which we design our systems. That's how we should manage it. Many European countries do that. It's more than sufficient if we have good water efficient aerators, like Mr. Gurmeet Singh was talking about, good flushes, good showers, and we have the mindset of efficient use of water. Some vignettes on what happens with water and groundwater. This is one of India's famous sons, Raghu Rai, one of the most famous photographers, and this is Agrasen Ki Baudi in the heart of Latian's Delhi. Notice the young lad diving in, notice the two swimmers inside the waters. And this is Agrasen Ki Baudi now. And this is a matter of from the 80s, early 80s to now, in the span of 30 years, 40 years, this is what we have done to our waters. The skeleton remains. We have retained the heritage, but the soul is gone. And we should ask ourselves, why is the soul gone? And should we not try to bring back the waters to the level they are? Why did the waters disappear? One reason, apartments around drilled borewells and drew out water, much, much more than replenishment could possibly occur. But the second reason is we built metros and metro stations, and those metro stations went underground, and those waters had to be pumped out if we wanted no flooding of our stations. And therefore, our infrastructure of the metro was not talking to the infrastructure of water. Similarly, the infrastructure of roads disrupt natural flows of nalas, drains, rivers, and rivulets, and do not talk to water. Surface water flows, hydrology is disturbed by road construction, and aquifer is disturbed by metros, basement parkings, and so on and so forth. Somewhere our master plans and building bylaws will have to start to realize the quantum that aquifers have and whether we need to protect them with our infrastructure requirements, right? It's not to criticize all these infrastructures. I'm just saying that the dialogue has been missing so long, and that dialogue needs to be reopened in our master plans and building bylaws. The water harvesting tradition in India is as old as Dholavira. Dholavira is the first settlement which did not depend on groundwater, but actually picked up river flows and stored it in these large ponds and then used it for the rest of the year. So this is the Indus Valley civilization. We're talking about 2900 BC, a 5,000-year-old civilization, the 5,000-year-old culture of water harvesting. Lothal with wells and drains. What we are trying to invent with Swachh Bharat and Jal Jeevan Mission, Lothal was doing 2300 BC, right? Small shallow wells, which gave water to the habitation, and drains, which took away the wastewater away from the city. And then the tradition of technology that we developed. So this is just a silent movie. Some of you may have been lucky to have seen this. A lot of the younger generation would not have seen it. This is the first pump, you would say, animal-driven pump. It's called the Persian wheel, Rehet, Aragatta, Ghati Yantra, Chakravatika, various names, beautiful devices invented in India. Somewhere around the area of what is now Rajasthan and Gujarat and Sindh, that's where these animal-driven, animal-powered water lifting devices were invented and discovered. Note, this is from open wells that is being drawn. You could only draw from 60 feet, no more. And there was a limit that you could irrigate, about 1 hectare to 2 hectares, no more. So there was a limit on the use of natural resources. And then we move to the era of hidden waters. The borewell drilling rig comes to India in the 60s, hard rock borewell drilling rigs. We start to drill into hard rock, basalt, granite. Now the camera is going 450 feet deep. It's a small 4.5-inch hole. And this is how water is coming into the borewell in hard rock terrain, right? From small cracks and fissures, 33 million borewells, 250 cubic kilometers of water, invisible to us, invisible to the user. We do not know what is the quality. We do not know what is the quantity. We're just pumping it out and throwing it on our land, evaporating it, growing sugarcane, cotton, rice, and wheat. Right? So how do we bring water literacy, especially groundwater literacy, and the recharge rainwater harvesting literacy to all our users is one big challenge that we will have to face. Therefore, groundwater regulations will need to kick in, and we'll have to start to understand and manage it better as a common pool resource. What does our history tell us? These are beautiful inscription stones found all across India. You know, the famous one of them is from Ashoka, but this one is from Anantapur district in Andhra Pradesh. And they are dated, and we can date them because they mention dates, right? So 870 AD, 800 AD, 1110 AD. And these are all inscription stones of the tanks or the lake system created in Bangalore city by our forefathers. This history of the tanks is 1200 years old, right? And some of the water harvesting structures are very peculiar to the particular area or the geographical context and the rainfall context, the sociocultural context. Like, for example, the Takas of Rajasthan, where a catchment is designed and a storage is designed so that water does not evaporate. And all water comes in, is filtered and stored, and is used for drinking and cooking purpose throughout the year, right? And then the tanks or the kerays, areas of South India and Bundelkhand and Gujarat, every village had a tank. What was the tank ecosystem? You threw an earthen bund across a channel, stopped the rainwater and stocked it up there. This is basic water storage, lake system, 1200 to 1400 year old. Overflow weir, every time the weir overflowed, there was a Ganga Puja organized. So there was a cultural association with the water and it was seen as great blessings. The people associated with it, the Nirugantis, these were people responsible for the distribution of the water. They would decide how much water is there in the tank, what crop can be grown, and how would the water be equitably distributed. The respect and the puja to Gangamma, you know, the one on the right, a float would be put in the waters and worship because the water had overflowed and that was the year of plenty. So culture, tradition, and the distribution of water, storage of water, were all interlinked. And below these tanks, even in semi-arid parts of India, the cultivation of rice paddy, right? So water was then transformed to rice and then stored for the rest of the year as food grain, sometimes up to 3 years. Beautiful scenarios. You don't have to go to Bali. You have to just come to the districts where tanks are there and where it's been a good year of rainfall, and you'll see this wonderful, wonderful lush green rice paddy cultivation, right? It's such a joy to the eye and it provides livelihoods all because water has been harvested. And when it is ripe, it's golden yellow in color. It's so such a gorgeous sight to see. Notice the well in the site, which is also full, right? Once the rice has ripened, the tank waters have been exhausted, but all the water has percolated into the ground and the groundwater is ready to be used for summer use like this. The groundwater table is high. And what does the groundwater do? The groundwater expresses itself in the architecture that we put around it. This is dry stone masonry. Not a gram of cement or lime has been used in the construction of this beautiful well. And it's full because the tank next to it has been desilted and stored with water. And this water would be used for drinking and cooking purposes, right? So the tanks and the wells provided drinking water security. Just adjacent to the tank, you see that there's a well there, and the well has good clean water because the earth has filtered the water from the tank. And this well, which is more than 120 years old, provides the entire requirement of the village, even during 3 consecutive years of drought. The challenge is, once we send piped water to homes at 55 LPCD, will we continue to treat water so wisely and will we continue to use it frugally? How do we do that is our challenge. Because that water is not only for us, it's also for all animals. It's for the ruminants, the sheep, the goat, the cows, the buffaloes. This is what the storage of water means, or water harvesting means, in the Indian context. So what is the modern interpretation? What do we have to do now in our cities? So we start to define it, because in scientific terms, we have to define rainwater harvesting, collection and storage or recharge of rain for future productive use. What are the components for plumbers, people, engineers who we design? A catchment, a conveyance system, a filtration system, a storage system, or a recharge system, or a combination of both, right? So this is the basic definition. Here's Sripadre, sir, my good friend, sending me the photograph. Catchment, conveyance, filtration, storage, all together in one, a sari in the Western Ghats of Kerala, which provides 300 days of drinking and cooking water because it rains 300 days. It's as simple as that, right? You see the catchment, you see the conveyance, the filter itself, the sari itself or the cotton cloth itself is the filter, and then that's the storage. It's as simple as that. What do we need to do in our cities and rural habitations? Look at the design of the rooftops. Keep the rooftops clean. Make sure that they are spick and span, right? As much as we keep our floors inside the home clean with sweeping and swabbing it, we need to make sure that our roofs are clean. And this is the system, how it works. Basically storage, filtration, underground storage tank, or a recharge well, right? I'll just go into the details as I'll show you more. What does it do in rural areas? Here, you see this lady with the blue hand pump. Below is a sump tank, is an underground tank. This is a fluoride prone area. an NGO called Bird K, Bife Institute for Rural Development Karnataka, has provided a 6,000 liter tank below the room, below the kitchen room, and put a small hand pump. All rainwater is stored, and you see the pipe behind her. The green thing is a filter. It's filtered in a sand filter and stored in the sump tank. And it provides her fluoride-free drinking water and cooking water throughout the year for the family. Simple systems providing solution from fluoride and arsenic. Essential for India. Or this system, where the roof is sloped in one direction, there's a pipe, a small outlet, and the tank behind these behind the little girl. It's about 2,500 liters. Once the tank fills up with one rain, it means 200 trips of 10-liter pitcher for the young girl would have been avoided. And the tank will fill up 3 to 4 times in a year. It may not be a complete replacement, it may be a supplement, but it's a major supplement. And the major benefit is to girls and women because they are the carriers of water in our villages, right? Or in this school, Mr. Pradeep had already mentioned about the schools in Gujarat. Here, the rooftop rainwater is collected in an over-the-ground tank, as you see at the back. And that tank provides the water for the sanitation facilities. It's a girls' school, and for the hygiene and sanitation of the toilet, rainwater is used directly from the tap. So simple systems where children learn what is the importance of rain, how much it rains, how the water is stored, and what good sanitation is, good hygiene practices. So therefore, what we need to learn technically is that the water that falls, the rainwater that falls, can be stored as soil moisture, surface water in our lakes and rivers, groundwater, the pipe water which comes from our city, from a dam or a reservoir, there's used water or wastewater, and then there is demand management. So these are the things that we have to deal with the water crisis that faces us in India. What happens is when we urbanize and build on a site, we stop infiltration and we increase runoff. That's what we do in a site. So what happens in an unbuilt site on the left, you see in Bangalore, and every city has to drop its own water hydrology, is 10% of the rain runs off and enters the storm drain, 3 to 8% recharges, 85% of the water is in the 1 meter of soil, and it evapotranspires. The moment you build on it on the right, 95% is the runoff, you have urban flooding, there is 0% recharge, and it's about 5% of evaporation. Altering the hydrology of the site has been incredibly damaging to groundwater, incredibly damaging to flooding situations. What rainwater harvesting seeks is biomimicry, going back to the original and making sure that we either harvest, store, or recharge that original water and keep make sure that we stick to the original. So what do we do in Bangalore? We created and studied the rainfall pattern, the daily rainfall pattern, and made a policy which says that for every square meter of roof area, you create 60 liters of storage or recharge. And for every square meter of paved area around your building, 30 liters of storage or recharge. And the recharge well has to be a minimum of 3 meters so that you push it below the clay layer and it enters the aquifer. Simple bylaws based on the rainfall pattern and the geology of a particular area. And so all cities have to do that. The rainfall data is available to us from the IMD, the Indian Meteorological Department, and the Karnataka State Natural Disaster Monitoring Center. Daily rainfall data is best. Monthly rainfall does not work, and work out a daily water balance for any unit that you're doing it. We are lucky that we have institutions like the KSNDMC, the Karnataka State Natural Disaster Monitoring Center, because it has put 100 rain gauges in the city of Bangalore. We have granulated data. We have data at a 15-second level of rainfall. We use that to study the intensity of rainfall and to design rainwater harvesting systems. Each city will have to find its own database and make sure that they design according to the rainfall pattern of that city. And we draw up a daily water balance. This is for the engineers. What we do is figure out what is the daily rainfall, what is the daily water demand, draw up a balance, and then optimize the storage system or the recharge system. So I'll just leave it to that. And this is how people are harvesting rainwater, like the one on the right. The left is the bylaw. This is a rain barrel where rainwater is stored, and the lady of the house uses it for gardening and non-potable purposes. You can, from the rooftop, see the clarity of the water and see those small bottles. These are H2S wild tests which check for bacteria. We use it, and many people use it for drinking and cooking purpose. The water, if the catchment is clean and if the filtration is good, is potable. It is absolutely sweet and good to drink, and it makes for great filter coffee also, just by the way. And somewhere our product designers, this is from a friend of mine, she shared it on Twitter in the UK, we'll have to start getting more products into the market which are able to store water and which look aesthetic and which fits into the middle class sensibility of good design. These products are still missing in the Indian context. We need to make sure that they start to come up. This is a rainwater tank. What does the National Building Code say? Well, it gives you the design for roof drainages, right? So for engineers who are designing, look at the National Building Code. It tells you the sizing of pipe based on the intensity of rainfall in your city, right? And the number of pipes you have to use. So codes are already available. A first rain separator is essential to separate the first 1.5 millimeters of rainwater or 2 millimeters of rain, which has the dust and dirt particles in it. And then you filter the water, then use it. You can have do-it-yourself filters like this one on the left, a basic filter with sand and gravel, or you have ready-made filters. There are many companies which are making excellent filters. There's R&D going on into the filtration systems, and more better products are coming in. The more products that are coming, the better it becomes, the easier it becomes to do rainwater harvesting. This, like I said, is Jugaad filter on the left, just a dhoti filter or a ferrocement filter with charcoal in it, charcoal and lime. So if you want to, you can keep it minimalistic. You can do it with absolutely minimum materials. Charcoal is a good filter. It removes odor. It removes the color of the rainwater. And then you can store it in the sump tank. Or as my friend Vijay Raj from the farmland system does, for large industrial buildings, you can harvest water. And these filters do the first rain separation also, as well as the filtration for the water to be stored. The first rain separated is put into a gravel pit. So many such entrepreneurs are coming forward for designing new products, which will make India much more resilient with rainwater harvesting. We have to understand the geology of the place, of a city. Hydrogeology is crucial. What we understand is where are the recharge zones? Where are the lineaments and the cracks and the fissures in the geology where putting groundwater will mean that the aquifer gets filled up. It's not everywhere that it can recharge easily. We need to put hydrogeological science into the system and into thinking. Another fascinating facet that we found in Bangalore, this is a traditional community of well diggers. They're from the Manuvadar community. They're called Od. They still go from house to house asking whether the wells that people have in them can be deepened, desilted, clean, put potassium permanganate, alum, and bleaching powder. So we are working with them in partnership in Bangalore, and we have a goal of 1 million recharge wells so that half the rainwater in Bangalore goes in. So what they do now is not only do the old traditional well, but make recharge wells to put water into the ground. So traditional livelihoods can be regenerated. This is how a recharge well is made. Three feet in diameter, 1 meter in diameter, 6 meters deep. The gentleman in the left is a well digger. He's dug there. He'll put precast concrete rings and cover it with the grill, as you can see it in the center, and put clean stormwater drain into these recharge wells so that it makes up for the aquifer, right? This is IIM Bangalore, where they have more than 64 such recharge wells. So partnerships can be created. There are designs for deep borewell recharge also, which is available again in the National Building Code. You can take a look at it. It's very easy design. This is how it looks like. In certain areas, you can do a recharge of the borewell that you have. You dig around it and you fill it with the filtering material. You poke holes into the casing. You wrap it with the material so that dust or dirt does not go in, and you lead rainwater into it. Make sure at all points of time that the catchment runoff is clean. It's not polluted with sewage or industrial effluents, right? Simple systems like the one on the left, where rooftop rainwater comes through a small drum filter and goes into the well, which is covered with a tarpaulin. Mr. Balasubramanian gets all his water requirement for the whole house throughout the year from his open well. There are more than 10,000 open wells in Bangalore. People don't believe it. We want to increase it and make it 1 million open wells, right? Because 1 million open wells will give you all the harvesting of rainwater and all the water that you need at 1/10, 1/20th the price of water coming from the Kaveri River. We can redesign stormwater drains, not to allow the water to go out of the site, but just to infiltrate by putting in a series of infiltration wells like this. And redesign them just to hold on to water and make sure that percolates into the soil so that the plantations on the side are served with water. So we need reimaginations of road design, stormwater drain design, infiltration wells, right? Don't forget the maintenance. The maintenance, as is being done in this ITC factory, and you notice the water level there. Clean water led into aquifers through these recharge wells or infiltration basins where water can be led in and put in. These are very simple things, very common things which architects, engineers, and even house owners can integrate into the building plans design. But let's also remember, it's not just about supply side augmentation. We also need to get into the era of measuring what we are pumping out or what we are drawing. So metering and pricing of water is essential. As much as water is a human right, it's also an economic good. And demand management will only come when we measure and we price. And that is the next step with rainwater harvesting. What do you do at a community layout level? So a community of 36 acres, 360 plots, what they would have done, because they're not connected to the utility, is 360 people would have drilled borewells into the earth. 1,000 feet is the depth of the borewell in this place in Bangalore, in Sarjapur Road. 360 straws emptying the same water from a coconut and competing with each other. Pretty soon, all of the borewells dry. One borewell would cost 2 lakh rupees. 360 into 2 is 7.2 crore rupees would have been dysfunctional within a matter of years. What do you do to reverse it? You ban private borewells. The community did that. You sink 3 common borewells, share the water, pipe it, meter it, measure it, price it, so that everybody consumes less than 20,000 liters. And you make recharge mandatory. So 360 recharge wells, putting all the rain into the aquifer, three bore wells drawing water measured so that it is less than what is put into the ground. So you draw less than what you put into the ground. You have groundwater tables coming up. With the monies that you collect, put a wastewater treatment plant, send the wastewater, treated wastewater to every home for gardening purpose and non-potable purpose. You become a net provider to the city rather than a net consumer. If all communities start to do that, the city will not run out of water. And Mr. Gurmeet Singh's worry about Bangalore being the next Cape Town, rest assured, Mr. Gurmeet Singh, we will not allow that to happen because we Bangaloreans take pride in our city as much as all citizens do that, right? So we are working towards finding solutions, driving solutions with community, with individuals, with apartments also. So this is what I explained to you. Communities are gathering together, cleaning up old wells, protecting old wells, making sure that they become recharge structures. The one on the bottom right is at a Dhobi Ghat where it's being cleaned up and brought back for Dhobi Ghat use, right? So we need community action, community mobilization, and a good narrative to spread the message. People connect to wells emotionally. So the last point I wanted to share is water harvesting at a larger scale. What do we do with our lakes and tanks, which are the water harvesting structures? One example of one lake, Jakkur Lake, 18.9 square kilometers in catchment. This is the lake in Bangalore, North Bangalore, 50 hectares in water spread. You will notice just below the brown patch, a wastewater treatment plant, a constructed wetland. Both rainwater and treated wastewater now comes in into this lake through this constructed wetland. This is how the wastewater treatment plant works. Because it's open to the community, Mr. Gurmeet Singh, it functions 24 hours a day. The wastewater treatment plant operators take pride in the plant that they operate. The community keeps a watch on it and makes sure that they work on it, right? So this kind of partnerships is also needed because wastewater treatment plants are not nuclear facilities. They are great learning centers. We should open it up to community and make them aware of where their waste goes once they flush the toilet, right? So that's what happens. It's located upstream of the lake. You see that? Wastewater treatment plant generates sludge. There's no heavy metal in this sludge. And each truckload of sludge, two truckloads are generated a day, sells as fertilizer for 10,000 rupees. Wastewater treatment plants, if designed well, can recover nutrients, can recover energy. 80% of the energy of a wastewater treatment plant can be recovered by the wastewater treatment plant itself, right? Now, the treated wastewater and the rainwater and the stormwater comes in into this constructed wetland. The constructed wetland is a great bird habitat, mammalian habitat, and a reptilian habitat. And it does the work of polishing the water further, removes nitrates, phosphates, and heavy metals. Birds come there. This is Lakeview Apartments, two of them. You see the Lakeview Apartment of the weaver bird, and you see the Lakeview Apartment behind, right? The weaver bird also returns the baya, and nature becomes the treatment of water beyond the sewage treatment plant. So once nature treats it, you see that polluted water is kept out of the lake, and then the birds return. But it also provides livelihoods for fishermen. The Fishermen's Cooperative Society manages the lake, harvests 250 kgs of fish. They take care of the water hyacinths and the macrophytes in the plant and proteins for the city, right? 200 to 250 kgs of fish every day. They take care of the lake. The fishers take care of the lake, make sure the water hyacinth is removed and the lake is kept clean. Partnerships have to be struck for livelihood, for water harvesting to be managed. Then the birds return. And the challenge is this, that a pelican consumes 2 to 2.5 kgs of fish a day. 2 kgs is 300 rupees, excluding GST. If you put GST, center and state, then it becomes 336 rupees because 18% GST. One bird, 336 rupees is the bill. 250 to 300 birds land up. What happens to the fisherman? Does he see it as competition or does he see it as partnerships? Now, this fisherman see it as a partnership that there's enough in nature for them as well as for the birds. Now, the painted storks don't migrate out of Bangalore. They stay in Bangalore. They have a UID card, a local election card, and they vote in the local elections. This is the kind of transformation we need. We need to transform our lakes as biodiversity hotspots, receivers of treated wastewater and rainwater, livelihood providers, and recharges of groundwater and aquifer. So the open wells around the lake now have this kind of water. This is drinking water. Rainwater, treated wastewater, becoming drinking water, providing livelihoods, providing biodiversity. This is the kind of imaginations we need with water. And we need to work with it to scale it up quickly and replicate it. And it's all possible with community and institution action. Because this is a great journey of water literacy, as Mr. Gurmeet Singh was pointing out, as others were pointing out, we need our youngsters, we need every citizen to be part of the solution. It cannot be the solution of 1, 2, 3, or 5 institutions and people. Everybody has to be part of it, including especially the youngsters, right? Because the only thing from history we learn from history is that we perhaps do not learn from history. That's what Hegel says. So do we really want to learn from history or do we want to stay asleep? That is a choice that is before us. And I think as participants, we can do the simpler things, we can do the complex things. And as a society and a community and with the government, we can overcome and we can do so with rainwater harvesting being the center, fulcrum of the transformation of water that India needs and the river rejuvenation that India needs. Thank you for your time and patience and be happy to take questions.
Mr. Vishwanath, super presentation. I applaud you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Very well done. Well done.
Thanks a lot for the interesting presentation and session, Vishwanath, sir. And it's time now for all our answers, question and answer session. So I'd like to invite Mr. B.O. Prasanna Kumar to start the Q&A.
Yeah, thank you.
Mr. Kumar, you're muted.
Yeah, sorry. Thank you, Mr. Vishwanath. Really scintillating information, and this is the need of the hour. One point I would like to take today is what you said is heritage remains and soul gone. So it is the time to revive the soul into the heritage so that we will become the carriers of the heritage and so we will address the need of the water for next generation to come. Really interesting. You made it with lots of examples and made it very interesting. And questions are also very less. There are some questions which I will take, which may be very simpler to you, but our participant would like to know from you. Is that interlinking of rivers and canal work in India?
It is better to focus on local water. It is better to focus on the rain that falls on our heads, no, in our villages, in our cities, and then to make sure that we live within those rainfall means and endowments. River linking is very expensive. It's ecologically and biologically very sensitive, and it will do great damage. It's best to learn from our forefathers and live within the means of rainfall. That's my opinion. And it's a politically very difficult question to answer. I would rather believe in decentralized small-scale approaches rather than large-scale approaches.
Yeah, yeah. I think our Mr. Y.S. Rao is satisfied with the answer. And that is also the way to do the things. Do it locally, make it globally. The same thing, you know, that is applicable here. And another question, sir, from Mr. Pramod. How can we store maximum rainwater above the ground level for the use for the entire year? That is his question.
So it depends on the demand that we have on the water, right? So we have a particular demand. We have to make sure that it's optimized. And then we can create storage, as Mr. Pradeep was showing, with large ponds in the campus itself, if it's a large campus, or underground some tanks or rain barrels, depending on what our demand is. It's not necessary to imagine it being stored for the whole year. Even if it's a supplement for 5 to 6 months, we should use rainwater and supplement it with groundwater or other forms of water. We need to phase it out, slowly phase it out and build it and make sure that we get 100% of water harvesting. But let's also remember one thing, Mr. Prasanna Kumar, that we are not entitled to all the water that falls on our campus. There is something called a downward dependency. So some percentage of the water, 15 to 20%, should be allowed to go downstream. If everybody starts to capture all the rain in their premises, that will not be just and fair to those who live downstream.
That's true, sir. That's true. Absolutely true. Because you need to look after that, all the ravines and rivers which are leading to subsequent places. So another question, sir, how many days rainwater can be stored in a tank?
Excellent question. So if the catchment is clean and if you're able to filter it and remove all the organic contaminants, then we can store it for 10, 12 years. It's not a problem. The water does not spoil. It's very important that organic material is removed from the rainwater which is stored there. And it's been done in Gujarat and Rajasthan for donkey's years. People would just put a copper bronze plate inside the water and use it for 3-5 years.
Yeah, that acts probably act as a disinfectant into this one, because what you catch the water is the purest form at its source, and you just need to do the disinfection by using copper or silver. Yeah. So another is, do rainwater need a treatment? Is this one in the urban scenario?
We do need to check it. There's a BIS 10500 guidelines for drinking water standards. We should send it to a lab, the first sample that we collect, and check for all parameters. The only parameter that is usually exceeded is coliform, right? Because in the air and in the dust, you can pick up coliform. So it will need basic treatments, biological treatment, You could do that through many methods. If you're using it inside the house, you can use a small filter, not an RO system, just a gravity-based filter, and that will do the job for you.
Sir, that is another pathetic thing that we want to know from you in some other talk. Is that RO really required? I am not touching that question now because I know you have got the very big answer, and this one will touch base in a next presentation with you, sir. Yeah. And another question, sir, how should we calculate the recharge potential of an aquifer? Is there any example or very simplistic term? Because calculation, we may not able to run for them now. At least some guidelines you can give it to them.
So one of the best things to do is something called a slug test, right? When you make a recharge well or a recharge pit, you fill it with a certain known volume of water and you observe the time taken for it to infiltrate and percolate into the ground. So what we have done with slug tests in Bangalore is we found recharge rates of 500 liters to 1,000 liters an hour, up to 10,000 liters an hour. So that gives you the capacity of the well as well as the recharge rate. The slug test gives you that. Therefore, you can design for the catchment, how much water can come from a certain catchment into this recharge well. Slug test is the answer.
Yes, sir. Thank you. And another question from Kolkata, Mrs. Babu Mukherjee. She is asking, is it possible to perform rainwater harvesting in a place where the houses are very close to each other and such as in North Kolkata?
A good question. What we need is first space between our ears, in our mind to find solutions. Many a time we think there is no space, right? But all the space that is required sometimes is just 6 inches of a tube well, which goes into the ground and you can put the rainwater into it and it goes there. The house that I showed you in the rural context where the lady was sitting inside with a blue hand pump, we didn't think that we could harvest rainwater. It was the lady who said, why don't you dig up my kitchen and put the rainwater tank inside my kitchen? And then you cover it up and you have a hand pump and therefore you have water in the kitchen for them. So many a time it takes more people to think about solutions rather than an expert to give the answer. So the lady from Kolkata, if she thinks about it, she'll find the answer.
Certainly. We need to work around that solution rather than problem now. Yes. Which is the best, other question, sir, which is the best possible method of groundwater recharging? Is it a percolation or an injection well?
So it depends on the geology and the soil condition. Sometimes you have clay, sometimes you have hard rock, in which case you may have to go for injection. Sometimes you have laterite, sometimes you have porous soil. There you can do indirect recharge. That is, you can put a recharge well or you can put a pond which infiltrates into the ground. It depends completely on the geology of the place.
The similar question is asked. I think the three of the participants, there was the same question. I think they got their answer by this. And sir, can you please elaborate?
There are a few questions in the chat box also. So
can you read that? Can you read that?
UP, can I ask one question to Vishwanath?
Yeah, please. Nivedita is reading now. After that, can you take up that, sir?
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
So one person has said, generally the reuse of rainwater in a project is a question mark since there is always excess STP treated water available for flushing and landscape. Can we convert it into potable water and reduce potable municipal water demand?
Absolutely. Mr. Pradeep has already shown by example, right, that you can do that. You can store the rooftop rainwater and use it to replace distilled water. You can use it to replace drinking and cooking water with simple filtration systems. And then the rest of the landscape water can be used for non-potable purposes, right? So just bifurcate between the rooftop water and the paved runoff, and you can use it for every purpose.
Sure.
I can see that there are...
Sorry.
Yeah, Vishwanath sir, I would like to ask one question. See, as a consultant over here in Ahmedabad in Gujarat, we do follow a practice of having rainwater tankas like we used to do in the earlier days. And we recommend making lime concrete tanks. So how effective are these lime concrete tanks in terms of storage of rainwater?
You should ask your grandfather, Mr. Minesha. You know the answer yourself. You know, Narmada water has spoiled the people of Ahmedabad. They had such a beautiful tradition. Every house inside the poles had beautiful tankas, and there was respect for that water. There was very careful and conservative use of water. And everybody, whenever you went into a house, would be offered water with jaggery. You know, the whole culture and tradition we have lost. We don't even offer water now when people come into our homes. At least the RO water also we stopped offering.
Correct. So I just asked this question just for the sake of all the attendees, so that the awareness can be created on this lime concrete tankers.
Well, lime is an excellent disinfectant. It alkalinizes the water also, and therefore it's a very good way of storing water.
Correct. Thanks. Thank you, sir.
Sir, Antar,
I believe there is a question from Mukesh Asira, sir.
Yes, go ahead, please. Go ahead, Nivedita.
You can take up another question in the meantime.
Okay.
So, Mr. Prasanna Kumar, I'd be happy to share my email ID. So if people don't get an answer and if they want to ask the question on email, I'd be happy to answer it later. I just wanted to let you know that.
Definitely.
Mr. Vishwanath, even at 6:25 in the evening, you have 500 people here and 150 on Facebook.
I finished in 30 minutes. I was timing myself. I was 30 minutes only.
No, I'm not telling you what your timing was, but you still have 650 people glued to you.
Correct, sir.
Very good presentation.
Mukesh Asidaji has asked, is injection permitted by law? If yes, what are the prerequisites?
Correct. So injection of rainwater is permitted by law. For your own safety and your own knowledge, you should make sure that the water that you inject should be of the highest standard, should be of the potable standards, right? Injection of treated wastewater is not permitted by law, but rainwater you can inject.
Sir, one of the commonly asked question in a project is, we are using treated water for our landscape and all these things. And in monsoon, all that water flows from our landscape going into the shallow recharge and deep recharge. What is the effect on the ground? How to curb this?
That is a very difficult question. You know, the zero liquid discharge norms which have been put in place means that we have excess treated wastewater during the monsoons, as you rightly pointed out, right? Now, if you're able to make sure that the treatment quality of the wastewater is of the highest standards, if we can get it to the highest standards, then we don't have to worry about it recharging the aquifer. Otherwise, we'll have to be worried about the aquifer. One of the ways to do it is to make small constructed wetlands so that the wetlands treat the water further and only that water is allowed to infiltrate into the ground. Small wetland-based pond and infiltration systems. We have to work a lot more on that to build the knowledge system there.
Yes, yes. I think it's a very complicated this one because both the side you are matching the requirement of government saying treat up to this level but may not be suiting to the recharging into the groundwater. I understand that. And in another question is natural lakes or pond, how aeration happens? And if we make it bigger, artificial lakes, aeration required? Is it aeration required? And this is a person from Chennai. Yeah, Mr. Jay Prakash is asking this question.
Sir, aeration, it depends on the DO level of the water body, right? So typically you need a minimum dissolved oxygen level of 4 parts per million, right? 4 ppm. If the water body is going below 4, and it may do so during the night, especially 2 or 3 in the night, when the algae is consuming all the dissolved oxygen, then you will need aeration. If it does not go below 4 ppm at the peak hours of the night, then you don't need aeration. So it's a question of monitoring and figuring it out.
Sir, one question from Dr. Rajkumar. Sir, can we drink rainwater before flow?
Sir, for 25 years, I've been drinking rainwater. The coffee that I'm drinking is rainwater. The long hair that I have is because I use rainwater for Bitshika Kai for my hair. So I can assure you, rainwater is good. And it's a Friday evening. I can also tell you it goes very well with Old Monk.
Sir, I'll tell you, Vishwanath, I have long hair too, but because we consume 50% tankar water, I have lost all my long hair. So
it's completely potable, sir. If you keep a check on the quality, absolutely good.
I know.
Yeah, one question, Sunil says, what about low TDS value of rainwater when it directly stored in tank?
Absolutely. So if we can add a bit of calcium and magnesium to the waters, then it will improve the water quality if we are going to consume it. Most of the time, if we have a healthy diet, our water did not have all the nutrients there. But if you add a bit of salt, calcium, magnesium, it helps improve the water quality of rainwater.
And probably, I don't know, this question to Mr. Pradeep, what kind of quality pipes you suggest, sir, for rainwater harvesting system, which makes rainwater clean and usable? Mr. Pradeep, unmute and...
Sir, I will call in our... we call him the Bhishma Pitama in our company.
No. Sir, good evening, Mr. Prasanna Kumar. Nice to see you. Nice meeting you after a long time.
Thank you, sir. It's a pleasure.
I'm Rajasekhar Birde here. So we, in fact, you can use our SWR pipe as well as agri pipe for external application wherever pipe is exposed to sunlight. I would recommend SWR pipe. Otherwise, agri pipe also can be used. So these two pipes probably can be used. And we do have casing and column pipe also. But basically for this purpose, I would recommend SWR as well as agri pipe, depending upon the application and the usage and the place of use.
Fantastic, sir. Fantastic. So you have a plethora of range of material with
Absolutely.
You. So people can make use of. Sir, another question to Mr. Vishwanath.
Thank you, sir.
He says, thank you. And we want to use the rainwater harvesting pit, but our ground is totally clay. Is there any specific type of pit you suggest?
So it depends on the city and the place that you are. If there's a small boring done to figure out how deep the clay is, typically what I found is that near tank beds and all, clay would be there up to 8 to 10 feet, maximum 12 feet. Maybe it is required that you drill a small bore or a casing, which goes to 30, 40 feet, and then your recharge rate will improve dramatically. It depends on the soil profile there.
Okay. Thank you. I think, Mr. Srinivasan, you got your answer onto this, because clay is totally impervious and cannot be done. That is what the conclusion. I think we are at 6:31 now. What is the way forward, Nivedita? Now we are closing. Any questions, we can take it to by email.
Can I ask one question, VOPK?
Yes, please, sir. You are.
Mr. Vishwanath, you see, as urbanization takes place and we build eye to sky, all the buildings now in Mumbai city are 50 stories plus. There is no place left for rainwater harvesting. So would you look at centralized harvesting here rather than decentralized? Like the Oval Maidan rainwater harvests a lot of water, you know?
True. So, Gunjit, it depends on how we look at it. Now, even in Mumbai, I assume that these flats would have space in the parking or in the basement for underground sump tanks, right? And even if you create the same sump tank and use the same sump tank, which is used for borewell water or the corporation water for rainwater, even one day storage means that in Mumbai, you get 150 days of your water requirement through rainwater harvesting, right? So we can start from there as much as is possible at the flat level, and then expand, as you rightly put it out, to the lakes, ponds, to the open areas, below the road, below the parking spaces, below the Oval Maidan storage, which Tokyo has been doing.
So it has to be built into design, right?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah, Nivedita.
Can I take one question?
Yes, sir, please. Yeah,
Vishwanath, it was a very excellent your presentation. Just I'm having one question. Because of the urbanization and the industrialization, there is a lot of pollution is there. And sometimes we hear that there is the acidic rainfall happen. So it is not continuous, it happens sometimes. But if you have put the rainwater harvesting system, and if such acidic rain goes into that one, what kind of the impact will happen on the soil or the groundwater?
So Shankarji, this is two advantages we have in India. No, most of our rain comes with a very strong breeze. The southwest monsoon brings a very strong wind, right? So the air pollutant load is completely dispersed. So acid rain only occurs just behind refineries, oil refineries and thermal power plants if the system is not working, just downwind of those. In normal areas, acid rain does not occur, right? Even if acid rain occurs, it's the first 1.5 to 2 millimeters of rainfall, which is a bit difficult to manage and handle, right? That should be separated out. And only after 2 millimeters of rainfall should you harvest it.
Yeah.
Thank you for answering all the questions in this informative Q&A. So for most of the people who have asked the questions, I would like to say that mostly he has tried to answer all the questions. And for others whose questions have not been answered, we will be sharing his email ID, so you can write to him directly, or you can send us the questions. We'll also pass on to him.
Mr. Vishwanath, 1 minute. Can I interrupt Nivedita?
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry. Mr. Vishwanath, we published the Indian Plumbing Today magazine, which goes to more than 6,000 people. You have spoken very beautifully. Can you please write an article for the magazine?
Sir, there are many people here who have been pushing me to write articles. I've been promising and not delivering. So, but I will do that. I will, with this article.
It goes to every professional in the MEP segment. So,
I'll definitely do that. I'll do it this time.
Thank you. Thank you,
Ashish. Thanks to the pandemic, I'm free at the home. So, I'll be able to do it.
Thank you.
It's a really useful documentation, sir, because many of the plumbing engineers lack of knowledge, in-depth knowledge on the rainwater harvesting. Mostly they are following the bylaws given. Sometimes they don't have the time to apply their mind to see that whether it is applicability of the land of where they are designing. Your paper would be really eye-opening for us. If you touch based on some calculation on this one, do's and don'ts of the rainwater harvesting system, sir.
I'll do that.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. I will follow with you to get the article to our magazine, sir. Thank you, Nivedita. You can take
it
over now.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So I express my gratitude to both of you for sharing your time and experience and wisdom with all of us here today. So before we close, I would like to inform all of you that we'll be back with an intriguing webinar next month on the last Friday of the month. So await more information from us, and you can keep checking the IPA website or the IPA social pages for more information. So now I'd like to call upon Mr. Shankar Ghime, Chapter Chairman, IPA Nagpur Chapter, to do the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Nivedita. It was a really excellent session by Mr. Vishwanath, and there were many takeaways from this session. As we are totally dependent on the water, and monsoon is the only source. So we should respect the monsoon. That is what Mr. Vishwanath has conveyed. And definitely water, groundwater cultivation. So that he has explained very much, very well. Then he has also touched the point of the tank ecosystem in the past, and still we should continue with that one. And we should keep our roofs clean so that catchment can be fruitful. Rainwater and rain is our everybody's business. That is the another takeaway, and we should follow to that one. And excellent and wow factor in his presentation. So I should thank Mr. Vishwanath for his excellent presentation, and we are benefited out of it, and definitely we'll keep on again troubling you for another topics. So thank you, Mr. Vishwanath. And today's session is started by Mr. Minesha. With his initial talk about what was happening in the past and now also, and with the catch line as the catch the rain where it falls and where it when it falls, of course followed by a talk show on the water by Gurmeet Singh Arora. It is another wow factor, and he is always excellent in giving the opening speech so that everybody is glued to the session, and many takeaways from his address. We should not forget about this work. This session was more successful because of the our partner Finolex and Mr. Pradeep Vedula, MD of the Finolex. He has given the what their company is doing for the building the dams, rainwater harvesting, effluent cycling, and they are more into the even CSR initiative for giving this rainwater harvesting also. And BO Prasanna Kumar, who has introduced Mr. Vishwanath, and he has only brought this speaker for this one, and we are benefited out of it. So I thank Dio Prasanna Kumar also, Manisha also, Gurmeet Singh Arora, and Pradeep Vedulaji. And there are many excellent questions from the participants, and I thank all the participants for this event, those who are benefited directly, indirectly, and our headquarters team for organizing this event more successfully, and of course, webinar team who is bringing this kind of sessions from time to time. Of course, this is the first session of 2021, because in last 2 months we could not do much because of the second wave of the pandemic. But now every month, fourth Friday of the month, we will have one national webinar. Stay connected with us and you will get updated of this one information. Thank you so much for each and everyone.
Over to you. Have a great weekend. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you everyone for connecting with us today, and goodbye for now.
Thank you.
until we meet again on 23rd July with an interesting topic.
Thank you very much. Thank you once again. Thank you
Mr. Vishwanath.
Thank you, Vishwanath.
Thank you.
Thank you, Vishwanath.
Thank you. Pleasure.